Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand. I want to be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come, let it live in me. This is my prayer, this is my plea. Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand, and I want to be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come, let it live in me. This is my prayer, this is my plea. Let the worshipers arise, let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all, I surrender to the King. Father, I hear it growing louder, the song of your redeemed, as the saints of every nation are awakening to sing. From our hearts there comes an anthem, oh, hear the heavens ring. This is a song to our King. Let the worshipers arise, let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all, I surrender to the King. Let the worshipers arise, let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all, worshippers arise, let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all, I surrender to the to the King. Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to our celebration service. If you guys would just stand with us, it's time to go to the Lord in our praise. And I'll be reminding you of this later, but the Lord has said some great things about who you are in Christ.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me.
Ooh, the sun sets free.
Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Free at last, he has ransomed me, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me.
Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. In my Father's house, there's a place yes, I am. I am chosen,
not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Oh, I am who you say I am. Ooh, the sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am.
In my Father's house, there's a place for me.
I'm a child of God, yes I am.
The sun has set you free, you are free indeed. I am chosen.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Oh, I am who you say I am. Yes, I am who you say I am. Ooh, the sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am.
That's right, Jesus said, in my Father's house there are many rooms, and I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I do that, I'm going to come back and take you with me. If the Son has set you free, then you are free indeed.
When the sea is calm and all is right, when I feel your favor flood my life, even in my good I'll follow you, even in the good I'll follow you. When the boat is tossed upon the waves, when I wonder if you'll keep me safe, even in the storms I'll follow you, even in the storms I'll follow you.
I believe
everything that you say you are. I believe and I have seen your unchanging heart, in the good things, in the hardest part. I believe and I will follow you. I believe and I will follow you. When the wicked prospering, when I feel I have no voice to sing, even in the want I'll follow you, even in the want I'll follow you.
And I believe
everything heart is mine. I believe and I will follow you. I believe and I will follow you.
When I find myself so far from home, and you lead me somewhere that I don't want to go, even in my death I'll follow you. Even in my death I'll follow you. When I come to end this race I've run, and I receive the prize that Christ has won, I will be with you in paradise. Oh, I will be with you.
I believe everything that you say you are. I believe and I have seen your unchanging heart. In the good things and in the hardest part, I believe and I will follow you. I believe and I will follow you. I believe everything that you say you are. I believe and I have seen your unchanging heart. In the good things and in the hardest part, I believe and I will follow you. I believe and I will follow you.
And we'll be following him, and you know the kind of the theme of this Sunday is call upon the Lord.
We need no other hiding place. Our hope is safe within your name.
Amen.
This we know, this we know. You promise never to forsake. What you begin, you will sustain. This we know, this we know. I will call upon the Lord, for he alone is strong enough to save. Rise your shackles on, O Lord, for Jesus Christ has broken every chain.
All of the heavens and the earth
announce the fullness of your word. This we know, this we know.
Here we go.
And every enemy will flee as we declare your victory. This we know, this we know. I will call upon the Lord, for he alone is strong enough to save. Rise your shackles on, no more, for Jesus Christ has broken every chain.
Amen.
Jesus' name will break every stronghold. Freedom is ours when we call his name. Jesus' name above every other. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Jesus' name will break every stronghold. Power.
upon the Lord, for He alone is strong enough to save. Rise, your shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken every chain. I will call upon the Lord, for He alone is strong enough to save. Rise, your shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken every chain. Isn't it good to call on the Lord? Would you guys be seated this morning? So, good singing with you. Oh my goodness.
Wait, what are we doing? We didn't coordinate this. What are you doing?
Are you
invocation?
Doing, yeah.
Okay.
Are you
cool.
Doing Bob right now?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Then
you're okay.
Okay. Got it. Okay, cool.
So.
Oh, he gets to. Don't worry. He's just going to go lurk over there. All right. Okay, cool. All right. 13 months have passed, maybe a little bit more. It's 6,742 miles from Japan to New York. And it's another 2,005 to get from New York back to Lander. So 8,747 miles later, and how many hours and countless prayers. We would like to welcome officially, in person, in the flesh, the Douglass family. So Rich, Donna, Zoe, Matilda, and Gwendolyn, we're so glad to have you guys in the house today and as part of our new church family. And we're just glad to begin our new next stage of church life with you. So once again, we just welcome you. Rich is somewhere, and but it's really good to see all of you over there. So Bob, would you please make your way up here? And Rich, if you would come up here and help me with this part. There are all kinds of leaders in the church, and the elder team are the head shepherds, and Bob has been affirmed to join the elder team again.
Praise the Lord.
Amen, for sure. So Bob served faithfully as an elder in the past and took some time off, but now he's back, so I'm glad to be serving with you again. He is a shepherd at heart. And his prayerful leadership is going to be an awesome and great addition. So I'm so glad to have you back and just be with us. So in this commissioning part, I wanted to use 1 Peter 4 and 5 to kind of help us. We've been through that recently. And just talk about shepherding. So Bob, and this is to all of us, but as elders, be shepherds of the flock, watching over them, not because you have to, but because you're willing and eager to serve. Yes, sir. Be an example to the flock. And above all, love each other. Love us deeply because love covers a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality and use your gifts, like you are, to serve others and as a faithful steward of God's grace. And so, come here in between us here and we'll just pray over you. So we'd like to just pray for Bob as he becomes one of our shepherds.
And if you're an elder of the church, if you've been an elder in the church, would you please stand right now? If you've been an elder in the church before, Norm Cooper.
Cool.
Church, please stand, and would you raise your hand as we bless Bob together? Thank you.
All right. Lord, we just give you praise, and we just ask for your spirit to be real and huge in Bob as he's a shepherd for us. Lord, we just pray for all of us who are elders and those in this church in leadership that your wisdom would just be real and evident. That and above all, Lord, we just ask that you lead us. God, just give us the way to go and help us to keep our eyes on you. And so we're so thankful for Bob to be part of this team, and we just ask your blessing on him as he is a new shepherd. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, you can. Thanks for. All right, cool. All right, well, now for my buddy Dave. Sorry to steal your thunder there, pal, but.
Well, welcome to the Free Church of Lander. And a special welcome to any visitors we have today. Please check out the Get Connected table in the lobby. And if you're not on our church email, it's a good time to get plugged in. There's a lot of good information there. There's a weekly update, so you can get your name, share your email at the counter there. Why don't you turn to Psalm 24 while I have a couple announcements, and there you are.
Just back here lurking. I just wanted to make an announcement again about our fellowship Sunday after church. We have lots of tables set up, one for each of our missionaries, and we'll have snacks from each of them, so come sample some foods. And then we have a special gift that we're asking for some help with. Yolanda and Andrew, who are our missionaries in Zimbabwe, Africa, are providing food hampers for the women that they work with, and the women that they work with keep sharing them. So they keep asking for more hampers because there's a really, really big need for food there right now. So if anybody wants to make a donation for that, that's available also. But please come and enjoy the food and the fellowship and getting to know our missionaries better. Thanks.
Are the Browns here? Raise your hand. Okay, that's one of our missionary families. Great. So it was about 20 years ago when I started coming to this church. The first thing I did was partner with Coulter, teaching second and third grade boys in Awana. So it's been great ministering with Coulter Brown. Okay, let's, one more announcement. So this coming Saturday, September 26th, at 6 p.m., we have a youth extravaganza. We're going to, any youth, whether you come to youth group or not, you're invited, middle school and high school age. So 6 p.m. here at the church, make your own pizza, cornhole, and nerds tournament. So please come. It should be a lot of fun. Okay, let's read Psalm 24 together. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to an idol or swear by what is false, he will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God his Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, O God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty. He is the King of glory. And then real quick, we're just going to zip to 1 Peter 1:17, 1:13, sorry. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Be self-controlled. Set your hope fully on the grace to be given you when Jesus Christ is revealed. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy, because I am holy. Let's pray. Lord, you are a holy God, and you're calling us to be holy too. forgive us of our sins. And thank you, Lord, that you've made us righteous through your blood, through your work on the cross. Lord, thank you for this special day, being able to be together physically with our pastor and his family. And we just pray a blessing on the beginning of this new era. We thank you, Lord, for all you do in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand with us again?
You hear the cry of the broken. You hear
is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save. Like your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it loud, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Lord, there's power in your name. Oh, there's healing in your name. Good to sing together about that. Know who our source of power is. Know who our shelter is. We'll finish up here. Let's sing.
Lord, I come and I confess, bowing here I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart.
All right, let's sing it like we know it. Here we go.
Lord, I need you. Your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are.
And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Lord, I need you.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, song to rise to you.
So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and save.
Lord, I need you.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. one defense and my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Lord, we just give you praise for this morning. We thank you that your presence is in this place, and you are the one that makes it all work. You are the one that makes our lives special because of the blood of Christ. In your name we pray, amen. Please be seated. Thank you.
Y'all can hear, whoa, whoa. Maybe you need to turn that off. I'm going to have to talk a lot quieter now. All right, open your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 3. Was I loud enough before? Could you all hear me in the back there, Amy? Yeah. Yeah. So you see these hands? These are pretty small hands for a guy that's 6 feet tall, aren't they? And you look at these little feet. I got little feet too. You know why? Because God made my mouth first. He ran out of skin. So, all right. I mean, there's just some things that are true, and that's okay. 2 Timothy chapter 3. In this part of Timothy, we find a verse that many of us are familiar with. All of you have probably heard it if you've been around church. This is where we find the doctrine of the inspiration of Scripture. Okay? All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, correcting, rebuking, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. How many of you heard that verse before? Right? But we need to learn to read our Bible in context, don't we? If you've been around church, you know that. If you haven't been around church, we want you to realize that. We have to read it in context. So we're going to back up just a little bit, and we're going to go into 2 Timothy chapter 3. Let's go to verse 14, and follow along with me if you would. But as for you, Timothy, Paul the apostle is writing to his disciple Timothy, who's now a church leader. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. All Scripture is God-breathed. What scriptures is Paul referring to? He's talking about the Old Testament. What are those scriptures, the sacred writing that Timothy has known from his birth? Well, that's not the New Testament. The New Testament's in the process of being written, right? We're talking about 62 to maybe 64 AD when Paul is writing this. The first book of the New Testament that we think was written was the Gospel of Mark. That was 40 AD. So Timothy, well, those verses, that's way before. And so if God says in the New Testament that the Old Testament is the Word of God, that is God's words that are written down by man, shouldn't we want to read that and study that and hear what the Lord has to say to us? Right? So yes, we need to look into the Old Testament as well. And we'll be doing that a little bit here and there as we move forward in this church, okay? And so, yeah, the Old Testament is something we want to study, even though we're New Testament people or New Covenant people. All right, next slide, please. Let's talk about where this book of Leviticus is in salvation history. Okay, so where is it in the Bible? We know that in the very, very beginning in Genesis, right, we have the creation, we have the fall, we have the Tower of Babel, and then we have the flood. Those are all stories that we're familiar with from Sunday school or just the movies, right? And then even after that, we have the time of the patriarchs. We have Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph. Right? And they're very, very famous people to us. And then we have enslavement in Egypt. For about 400 years, the nation is down in Egypt. And after that, we have the Exodus under Moses and all of the great stories that come from that. And then the Jews come forward and they go across the Jordan after wandering in the desert for 38 years. And under Joshua, they conquer the promised land. And after Joshua passes away, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Right after that time, we have the time of the judges. We're going to talk about judges in about 9 weeks. But that's not a very good time in the history of salvation, because everyone does what is right in their own eyes, and it doesn't go well. And then they ask for a king. And so God gives them a king. And the first king is Saul. He doesn't do so well. He's really tall, but that's about it. But then we have David. And David is the great king. And under David, we have the kingdom united and all of those great stories, slaying Goliath and doing all the cool things that he does. After David, though, we have Solomon, David's son. And he's supposed to be the wisest man in the world, but he marries 1,000 women. I don't know about that. Woo! I can barely handle the one, but he's a bigger guy than me. But Solomon's son Rehoboam is the next king, and he obviously did not inherit his father's wisdom. He makes some really stupid decisions, and right after that, we have the kingdom divided. Israel, 10 of the tribes of Israel, separate and become their own country. And we have Judea in the south, and then we have Israel in the north. And that's not a very good time. We have all the kings that follow after that. Whole bunch of bad kings, a couple of good kings, but mostly bad kings, even in Judah, down in the south. Things aren't working out well. After that, well, God judges the nations, Israel and Judah, both. They are carried off into exile for their sin, for their sinfulness, for their refusal to worship the one true God, for their turning back to the idols. And Assyria comes in around 700-ish AD and takes, whoop, out goes Israel, those 10 tribes in the north. And then Babylon comes in around 500-ish AD, almost 600 AD, and whoop, they take those people into exile as well. And that's where Daniel, remember Daniel was taken into exile into Babylon, and that's where he falls into this history. 70 years later, fast forward, after the exile, everyone starts to come back. Well, at least the ones from Babylon do, and they rebuild the temple, and they rebuild the wall around Jerusalem. And this is recorded for us in Ezra and Nehemiah, if you remember those stories. And then after that, we have the silence. For 400 years, God stops speaking to the nations. Until one day, there's a baby born in a manger. Where is Leviticus in this history? Well, it's in that time of the Exodus under Moses, right? We have Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Those are the books of the law, the first five books of the Bible, what we sometimes call the Pentateuch, Penta, like Pentagon, right? Those first five books. That's where Leviticus is. But Leviticus is even in a more interesting place than just that. Let's go to the next slide. Let's look at the immediate context for the book of Leviticus. When is this happening? 10 weeks after the Red Sea crossing, the Jews, the nation of Israel, arrives at Mount Sinai. And we know that because in Exodus 19:1, it tells us that. And then the law is given to Moses. Remember the tablets? He makes the tablets and he comes down and he's angry because of the golden calf and he breaks all of that. Well, that happens. And then afterwards, the construction of the tabernacle, the tent where the Ark of the Covenant, we all know the Ark of the Covenant. Thank you, Indiana Jones. You're a wonderful preacher, right? But we know that tent is going to be there. And the construction of that tent begins. And that is covered through Exodus 16 through 40. It takes about a period of 9 months. We know that the tabernacle, once it's constructed, it's put up, it's erected. And it's on the first day of the first month, according to the book of Exodus, in chapter 40. And we know that the Numbers, the next book of the Bible, it begins on the first day of the second month. And so that's also in Numbers chapter 9. And so what we find out is that Leviticus occurs about a year after the Red Sea crossing, and it covers the events of 1 month. That's it. That's where Leviticus is. You think, wow, this really important book where we learn all about these cool things that God is setting up, but it's a period of only 1 month. That's interesting. Go to the next slide for me. Some more context. That's where we are chronologically in the context. Where are we in the context of God revealing his plan of salvation? And we have to understand that God is revealing this through a man by the name of Abraham. God makes this three-part promise to Abraham. It's called the Abrahamic covenant. There's many covenants in the Bible, but folks, this one's the really, really important one. And some of you might be saying to me right now, well, Rich, aren't we new covenant people? We don't need to be involved in the old covenant. Well, That's what we're going to study in your small groups this coming week. Last week we had an announcement about small groups, didn't we? And we talked about how we're going to make our small groups sermon-based. And so we're not just going to rehash the sermon. Y'all have to listen to me once, and if you want to listen again, you can do that online and watch the video. But we're going to go deeper into certain subjects that we need to go into to better understand what God is saying to his people. And so this covenant, the new covenant, old covenant, Abrahamic covenant, how they all fit together, you're going to learn that in your small groups much, much more than we're going to cover today. But get in a small group, right? Here's my plug. This is my pastoral plug for small groups, folks. Small groups are a wonderful opportunity for you to increase your faith, for you to practice what we preach. They're the time where you get to come together with your brothers and sisters in Christ and really dig into the Bible and ask questions and figure things out. So if you're not in a small group, I highly encourage you to do so. Who here does not want to grow in their faith? Anyone? Zoe, do you want to grow in your faith, honey?
Yes, sir. I'm in a small group. It's called Douglas. My small group leader is my mother.
Get in a small group. It's a great opportunity. So this three-part covenant, we're going to talk about that. Some of you may be saying, well, I'm a new covenant person. Well, if we go to the book of Galatians, open up to Galatians chapter 3. Let's read that together. See what the Holy Spirit says through the pen of Paul. Galatians was one of the first letters that Paul wrote. It's in there somewhere. After Corinthians, Galatians. Galatians chapter 3. We'll go to verse 28 and 29. So the Holy Spirit says through the pen of Paul, there is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ's, is everyone here Christ's? Anyone? Yeah, think so. If you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to promise. All of you Gentiles that you are all Abraham's heirs. And this promise applies to you and me. And so, yes, the Abrahamic covenant is something that's absolutely critical for us to understand, because it's through this that we learn about how God plans to save sinful man from himself. This is where we're going to learn about the plan that God has. All right, next slide, please. This Abrahamic covenant, it has three parts, as I mentioned before. There's the land, the seed, and the blessing. And like many covenants or prophecies in the Bible, there's often a fulfillment for Israel itself, and then a second fulfillment in the time of the Messiah, in the time to come. This is what we call a double prophecy when we use theological terms. And so we look at this land, this seed, and this blessing. The Lord promises to Abraham that he will give them all of the land that he now comes into when he comes to Canaan. And this is about to happen. Remember, the book of Leviticus is just before the book of Joshua, and during the time of Joshua, that's when this is actually fulfilled. So after about 38 more years of wandering in the desert from the time of Leviticus, that's when the Jews are going to actually cross the Jordan River and conquer the land. The second piece, seed. God promises to Abraham that your descendants will be as numerous as the grains of sand on the sea or the stars in the sky. This has already been fulfilled at this time when Leviticus is being written. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph. Jacob takes his family down to Egypt, where Joseph has become the second most powerful ruler in all of Egypt. He takes about 70 persons, it says in the scripture. 70 persons is 70 males. Sorry, ladies, that's how they used to count back then. Trust me, we count different now today. We're glad you're here. But that means probably about 200 to 300 people went down into Egypt. And after about 400 years, they all left under Moses. And we know in the book of Numbers that it tells us how many they are then. They're 605,000 men. So 70 men and their families in the period of 400 years becomes 605,000 men and their families. Scholars estimate this is about 2.5 to 3 million people. So God has already fulfilled this promise that he gave to Abraham. You have 200 to 300 people become 2.5 to 3 million. That's a lot. I was an English major. I'm not very good at math, but it sounds like a lot to me. And then blessing. God says to Abraham, I'm going to bless you. And through you and your offspring, you are going to bless the entire world. And that's what we're going to camp out on today. It's this third part of the promise today that we really want to discuss. The question is, how was Israel supposed to do that? How were they to be blessed by God? And that was to occur because holy God was going to live in their midst. They were going to be a people that God dwelt with right there alongside them. And we see this in the Old Testament. The tabernacle's right in the middle of the camp. And whenever they march, it's right in the middle of all of the walking that goes on. That was God's plan. And the people, they were called to bless the whole world by living a life that reveals God is in their midst. It was through their example of being different that God would use them for his purposes to teach the whole world that God exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. The book of Hebrews tells us that. They were to live a life of obedience and purity as opposed to rebellion and sinfulness. Does any of this sound familiar? I mean, if you think about it, isn't this very similar to what we're called to do as Christians today? Let's go to the next slide. A little bit more about the book of Leviticus. The Hebrew name for this book is very, very important. It's critical to understanding this. We call it Leviticus in our English Bible because it's about the Levites, the tribe that has all of the priests in it and does all the sacrifice. In the Hebrew Bible, they call this Weyikra. Weyikra. And what that means is, and he called. So in the Hebrew Bible, the name of this book is, and he called. And when you go to the very, very first verse of the book, it says, the Lord called Moses and spoke to him from the tent. If you go to the first verse of the next book of the Bible, Numbers, it says there, the Lord spoke to Moses in the wilderness of Sinai in the tent of meeting. That's absolutely critical to understanding what's going on. There is a problem. Moses, the people of Israel, cannot enter into the presence of God. And God cannot be in their presence at this time because there's a problem. Any idea what that problem is? Sin. Specifically, the sin of the golden calf incident, where Moses comes down with the two tablets and they're all worshiping the golden calf instead of God. And he throws down the tablets. Remember that? So God has to do something about that because common man, through his sin, has become unclean. Well, here's what we know about the book of Leviticus right now. It gets the job done, doesn't it? Because in the beginning of the book, God speaks to Moses from the tent. Well, by the absolute next book, which is only a month later, Moses can actually enter into the presence of God and speak to him face to face like a man speaks to a friend. So it's really important that we see that. Well, let's look at the structure of the book. Next slide, please. Well, we're good. First half of this book, it climaxes in what's called the Day of Atonement. Yom Kippur. Have any of you ever heard that before? The Day of Atonement or Yom Kippur. Guess what today is? Does anyone know what today is? Rosh Hashanah. What is Rosh Hashanah? The Jewish New Year. This is the time where the new year on the Jewish calendar begins, and it's today. It's a two-day celebration. Today's the last day, the big celebration day of Rosh Hashanah. When I was a little boy, we'd be eating a lot of food today and doing a lot of dancing. Hava Nagila. Anybody heard Hava Nagila? I won't sing. I'll leave that for Chad. He's much better at it than I am. But that's what Rosh Hashanah is. Next Sunday is Yom Kippur. Isn't that amazing? Yom Kippur, in the history of the Jewish religion, in this Old Testament, that's the day where Israel gets right with God. They confess all of their sin from the entire year. And that's what it's all about. The second half of the book of Leviticus, it climaxes with the year of Jubilee. This is where we get right with all of our brothers and sisters with whom we live. This is when slaves are released, when property is returned, when debts are forgiven, and social harmony is re-equalized after 50 years of business and life and all of that. That's all in the book of Leviticus. We're going to look at some more structure in just a moment, but we have this vertical getting right with God thing in the book of Leviticus, and then we have this horizontal getting right with our fellow man in the book of Leviticus, and it kind of reminds me of something. I don't think that was really what was intended. I don't think God is painting us pictures in the scripture. I think he used words, but it does make you kind of scratch your head a little bit, doesn't it? Next slide, please. This structure becomes even more specific. Can you all see that slide? Is that big? Yeah, it's big enough. It's tiny on my screen. So in the very beginning, we have the ritual sacrifices in chapter 1 through 7. And then we move into 8 through 10. And that's the priest's ordination. And then we move into 11, no, it looks like 12 through 15, ritual purity. What does it mean to be unclean and clean? And we'll unpack that later. And then we have this centerpiece, the Day of Atonement. And following the Day of Atonement, we have a couple book or a couple of chapters about moral purity. And then after that, we go into the priest's qualifications. And then finally, we go into the ritual calendar. And what we see, if we go to the end of this, we see that we have these ritual sacrifices and these ritual calendar, kind of like bookends. And then we move in a little bit, and we have the priest's ordination, and then we have the priest's qualifications. The bookends get a little closer. And then we have ritual purity and moral purity. Again, the things are just getting closer and closer, and now here in the very center is what? Oh, the Day of Atonement. When the people get right with God. It's more like a mountain, if you think about it, as we put it together. And interestingly enough, not only is this structure in this book this way, this is what we call a chiasm in Scripture. It's a poetical device. Like we have rhyme in English, in Hebrew, you don't ever want to rhyme words. Right? That's a lot of Hebrew. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam. So you can't rhyme very well in Hebrew, but they use poetical devices like we do as well. And one of those is called a chiasm. And we'll see this in our New Testament as well, because our Hebraic authors use this poetical structure as well, and it works well in the Greek too. So we have this chiasm all focusing on the Day of Atonement. But guess what? The book of Leviticus is also in the center. It's in the center of the law. We have Genesis, right, the beginning, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Everything in the law, the Pentateuch, the books of Moses, everything pinnacles at the Day of Atonement. It's all pointing somewhere, isn't it? All of us know this today because we have to remember what Augustine said. Augustine said the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed, and the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. What do we know? What was God pointing at when he put all of this structure together? Remember, this is God breathed. This is inspired by God. What's he pointing to? He's pointing to a day. He's pointing to a very specific day where God will deal with all of men's sins. That's what this is all pointing at. That's what the beauty in this structure is. And geeky Bible guys like me and like our brother Aaron, we're the geeky Bible guys. We love this stuff, right? It's really fun and exciting. Who's our English teachers? Anyone an English major? Anyone? Anyway, there's one. Ron's one. I can't see that far. We got a couple. That's Valerie. Is that Valerie? Yeah, we love this stuff. Hey, it's kind of hard to see up here. Well, that's what we're seeing. We're seeing that God is pointing us forward to what he's going to reveal in the New Testament. Next slide, please. One of the important things we have to understand is this whole thing about being holy. Open your Bibles again to 1 Peter chapter 1. We just finished a couple weeks in 1 Peter, didn't we? Let's go into 1 Peter chapter 1. Dave read this for us. I want to read it again. It's really an important concept for us to understand when we look into what is God saying to us. 1 Peter. It's always hard for me to find 1 Peter. First Peter says in chapter 1, verses 14 and on, as obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all of your conduct. Since it is written, you shall be holy as I am holy. Next slide. What is Peter quoting? Peter is quoting Leviticus. Believe it or not, five times in Leviticus it says, be holy as I am holy. And what does that mean? Be holy as I am holy. What that means is live a life that testifies God is in your midst. Be unique. Be different. Next slide. What is holy all about? In the Hebrew, it's this really interesting word, kadosh. And in the Greek, we see this again in our New Testament. Peter writes in Greek, hagias. Right? That's this word holy. And it means set apart. But it means much more than just set apart. It's much more tied to God's identity. Who is God? God is holy. That's our word that we try to use to describe all of the attributes of God. This is about being completely unique. It's about powerful, omniscient, beautiful, and good. That's what it means to be holy. All of the different facets of this diamond that we call God. And that's what we're called to do. And so when we look at holy over the next 8 weeks, we need to look at holy that way. What does it mean to be completely unique, different, beautiful, and good? We're going to cover this clean versus unclean issue. I mentioned it earlier. It's not a big thing to go into today. What we do need to know today is that unclean common man cannot go in the presence of the holy. They cannot exist in the same space. And man, because of his sin, becomes unclean. And so we need to figure out, how is God going to take unclean common man and make him clean common man so that they can exist together, that they can live together, that they can be one with one another? Well, how does God plan to do that? It's through the blood of a sacrifice. Okay. And we'll unpack that even more as we go forward. Next slide, please. Some common misperceptions. Oh, we'll go to that slide. That's fine. Why would God, a good God, create a sacrifice plan? Why would he put this together? Well, God's plan was to live with man originally, wasn't it? God was going to live with Adam and Eve in the garden. but then Adam sinned. And then God plans to live with Israel and be amongst them in the camp, but then Israel sins. And so God has to figure out, how is he going to make this work? How is he going to get unclean man clean again so that he can live in harmony with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit? And we know in the book of Leviticus, we're going to unpack that it's done through the blood of a sacrifice. But all of this is also pointing forward, isn't it? God is still planning to live with man. In fact, doesn't he live in us who are Christians? So we're going to talk a lot about that. The question is, can holy God live with sinful man? And how can an infinitely holy God live with sinful man? And the only way to do that, the only permanent way to make that possible, is through a sacrifice of infinite value. God gives himself that he might give himself. God gives himself, God, the Lord Jesus Christ, on the cross, that he might give himself and we might have relationship with him, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, in all eternity. That's what this unclean, clean thing is all about. It's all pointing forward to the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Next slide, please. The sacrificial system, it never was intended to be a means of buying favor with God. That wasn't what it was all about. What it was really about was receiving grace from God. We get mercy and grace. Mercy is not getting what you deserve, right? Mercy is not getting what you deserve, because as sinful man, what do we deserve? Well, Scripture tells us we deserve death, for the wages of sin is death. But we don't get that. Christ pays the penalty for our sin, and we now we're wiped clean. All of the debt we have because of our sin is gone. The ledgers are balanced. We're a bunch of zeros. Oh, that doesn't sound very good, does it? But see, God doesn't leave us there. God, in his grace, well, we said mercy was not getting what I deserve. Grace is getting what you do not deserve. It's a little confusing there, but grace is getting what you do not deserve. And that's what we get as Christians. God doesn't leave us as a bunch of zeros. He actually adopts us into his own family. And we become brothers and sisters in Christ with God the Father. And the Lord Jesus, he's our elder brother. If you think about family relationship, God lifts us up and we become co-heirs with Christ. And the plan is God is going to live with us in the new heavens and the new earth. God has nothing. Well, that's what this sacrificial system is pointing forward to. God is planning to live with man, and he gives to Israel the means by which they can deal with their sin. Just like he gives us today the means by which we can deal with our sin. And Israel is called to live this life of practical obedience. And that's commonly misunderstood as well. It's not a bunch of arbitrary rules. It's not about achieving anything. You're not going to achieve your salvation. If you've been around church at all, we know that that's a common message. You cannot achieve your salvation through your good works. But we're called to do good works. God has created us for good works, Ephesians 2, verse 10. And so we're to do these. But what these works are about is about living a life that reveals God is in us, is in our midst as the church. Don't you know you yourselves are God's holy temple and the Spirit lives in you? When it says that, it means y'all. I love my Southern brothers. And if you hear me say Southern, I'm not from the South, but I picked it up when I was in the military. It means, don't y'all know that y'all are God's holy temple and that God's Spirit lives in y'all? And it's just the truth. That's what we are supposed to be recognizing when God calls us to do certain things and don't do others. Right? Don't play cards. Don't smoke. Don't drink and don't chew and don't date girls who do. Right? Anybody ever heard that before? Some of us that are over the age of 50, we've heard that a few times, right? Although I think here in Wyoming, you might find a few girls that chew, but we'll see. Donna gave it up just last week. So we have these misperceptions, right? And we need to remember those. Next slide, please. How does Israel maintain relationship with God? What are they supposed to do? Well, God provides it. He established the means by which they could be redeemed. The Passover, right? We've heard the story of the Passover lamb. And God continues to redeem Israel when they cross through the Red Sea. He does it all, right? He provides everything for them. And then God also sustains them. And he does that by giving his forgiving grace. And he sets up this system by which that can be expressed. And that's what Leviticus is all about. But Israel's called to respond to God's grace by living a life of obedience, by living out God's purposes for them. Does any of this sound familiar to you as Christians? God provides, God does it all. He paid it all. He does everything that is required for us to move into salvation. But we must respond and live out his plan for our life, which is for his purpose. And what's he all about? What is God's purpose? What's he doing? That's not a rhetorical question. I'm your new preacher. You'll find out sometimes I ask questions that aren't rhetorical. What is this whole book about? If you could say it in one word, what would you say this book is about?
Purity.
Purity. Love. Living with God. Salvation. Grace. What's that in the back? God's glory. This book, the B-I-B-L-E, the Basic Instructions Before Leaving Earth, what that's all about, y'all haven't heard that one? Man, honey, these people in Wyoming, they live out in the middle of it. That's good. I like it. I'm going to be able to tell all my old jokes. What this is a book of is the instructions for how God is going to redeem sinful man. If you really want to put one word on it, I read this in a book a long time ago and I really liked it. Redemption. That's what this is about. This book is about God's plan to redeem sinful mankind. It has some other good stuff in it too. We'll talk about those in the future. Next slide, please. What about us? What are we supposed to do? Well, Israel was supposed to recognize and respond in obedience. And there's something we need to understand. Grace is not opposed to effort. It's opposed to earning. That's written in a really cool book as well. Aaron's laughing. He's read that book too. Grace is not opposed to effort. We are to work in this. We are to put some elbow grease down. Grace is not opposed to effort, but it is opposed to earning. It's important for us to understand that. It's not about achieving. This life to which we're called is not about achieving anything. It's about living distinctly so that people recognize that God exists. He lives among us. Remember, there's that in the book of Acts. You all studied the book of Acts with Pastor Matt a few years ago. And there's that one part in the book of Acts where the disciples, they're amazed at these fishermen have this learning. And what do they say about them? They knew they had been with Jesus. Wow. They were living a life that revealed God was in them. And that's what we're called to do. We're to live this life of purity. Somebody said this book is about purity, and you're darn right it is. But purity is not about arbitrary rules. It's not for teenagers or for singles. It's for all of us. How many of you teenagers out here have heard about purity? You've heard about purity? You're too young to hear about purity. No, you've heard about too. That's not just for everyone. That is for everyone, not just for our youth. It's about showing how we live a different way than the rest of the world. And unfortunately, I think that's pretty easy today, isn't it? It's pretty easy to be distinct from this world that you and I are in right now today. We are to be set apart for God's purpose. We are blessed to have God amongst us, living in us as a church. And we are to be the blessing for those around us too, aren't we? Next slide, please. There we go. What are we supposed to do? We're to recognize God is holy. God is completely unique. God is not like any other God. All roads do not lead to heaven. In none of those religions does God come down and save you from your sin. In every single one of those religions, you must work to achieve your salvation. You must work to achieve the end of Buddhism, where we all just evaporate into the eternal consciousness. Hinduism, it's about possibly pleasing all of this multitude of gods. Islam, it's about pleasing Allah. And at the very end, Allah in his whim decides whether or not you will be saved. No, all religions don't come to the same place. Christianity is the only religion where God comes to live with man. It's the only religion where God does everything that is needed for salvation, and he offers it as his free gift. God is completely unique. He's powerful. He's all-knowing. He's beautiful. He's good. And he loves us. That is holy. We're to recognize that. We have this book where God reveals himself that we might understand that better. We also need to recognize that God has the right to tell us what is right and what is wrong. Ooh, we don't like that in North America, do we? How many of you like being told what's right and what's wrong? Anyone really excited about that? And it's hard, folks, but we have to remember, he created us. He created this land that we have, North America. All you got to go is up to Yellowstone. How can you not believe in God after touring Yellowstone? I mean, it's just hard, isn't it? I remember going there and just being amazed at the diversity of the park itself. We need to recognize God has created all of us, all of this. All that we receive is his, that he's entrusted to us for a time. And he has the right because he made us. All of us were kids at one point, and we had parents. And we didn't all live with our parents. I didn't live with one of my parents for my whole life. I never knew my dad. But at some point, your mom and your dad, who made you with God, but they made you, well, they have a right to tell you what's right and what's wrong. How many of you parents feel you have the right to tell your children what's right and what's wrong? Christy, do you have that right? Sure. How many of you children, because I'm a child too, how many of you children think your parents have the right to tell you right and wrong? Hey, why are you raising hands for her? The truth is, folks, he does. And not only that, God paid the price for our wrong through a sacrifice of his own son. Remember Abraham? We've been talking about Abraham a little bit today. He's called to sacrifice Isaac at one point in the book of Genesis, isn't he? But God says, nope, don't do it. And what's waiting in the thicket? The ram. There's a ram with its horns caught in the thicket. God provides the sacrifice, looking forward to the sacrifice of his own son. He doesn't make Abraham do what he will do himself. Holiness, though, is not a private affair. We need to understand that, folks. In our age, especially here in North America, we say that if it's consensual, it's okay. That's not true. We say that I'm doing my own thing. As long as I do my thing and it doesn't hurt anyone else, it's okay. That's not true. The pagan world has been suffering for 2,000 years because the church has not done what Israel itself didn't do for thousands of years before them. Israel was supposed to reveal to God, or reveal to the world, that God exists because he lives in them. And the church was supposed to do that too. We are called to live this life for God's purposes, not our own. We are called to reveal God is alive. He is real. He exists, and he rewards those who earnestly seek him. Living this life is not a private affair, at least not for a Christian. Next slide, please. What are we supposed to do to respond? Israel was supposed to recognize and respond. We're called, well, Scripture is very clear, repent and believe the gospel, the good news that God gave his son Jesus, fully God, becomes fully man, lives a perfect life, suffers, dies, buried, on the third day rises again, ascends into heaven, he's seated at the right hand of the throne of God, and he will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. Where's that from? Anyone remember that? Come on, you good Catholics, where are you? I know you're in here. That's from the Nicene Creed. This is the statement of faith of the third century church. That's the gospel, folks. We're called to repent of our own selfishness and believe the truth of what God has done. We're called to repent and be baptized. Why? Every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of sin. We need to accept God's gift that he gives to us. And we're to confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. And we're going to talk about that starting in about 8 weeks from now as we move into the next thing. Right now we're going to talk about Leviticus and what does it mean that God is our Savior. And then the next section of that we're going to do until Christmas time is going to be about what does it mean that Jesus is our Lord. That'll be fun. Next slide. We're to live a life that shows God is in our midst. If we open up our Bible to Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, we're to present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. We are to be not conformed to this world, but transformed by the renewing of our mind. We're to open up this book. We're to dig into it, we're to study it, we're to discuss it, and we're to understand it, and we're to allow this head knowledge to become heart knowledge. And we'll talk about how that happens. We experience it. That's how that happens. That's what we're called to do. Next slide, please. Folks, Jesus did. He's our example. If you're a Christian today, we're all becoming more like Christ. We've heard this before in church, haven't we? We're to become Christ-like. That's the whole purpose of sanctification, to use those fancy church terms. The life that you lead between becoming a Christian and mortal death, where you sin less. You're not sinless, but you learn to sin less and you learn to love one another. What are God's two greatest commandments? Love the Lord your God and love your brother as yourself. What does Jesus say? A new commandment I give you. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. How did Jesus love us? Unconditionally, completely, and sacrificially. Why? As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all men will know you are my disciples, if you all, y'all, love one another. That's the plan, right? Pastor Joe taught us that here when we walked into John chapter 13 a few months ago, remember? This is God's plan, and Jesus did that. He left heaven, came down to earth, lived a perfect, sinless life that we might have him as our sacrifice on the cross. How do we know he lived a sinless life? It says in the book of Hebrews, chapter 4, right there. He was the one who in every respect was tempted as we are, but without sin. He was the perfect sacrifice. And we'll talk about that next Sunday. Come back. It's actually pretty cool stuff. Next slide. What would our world look like if we did? If we loved one another the way Jesus has loved us. What would that look like? Well, you know, the elders came and they taught us a whole bunch of good stuff in the book of Peter. And we've had a lot of good teaching about that, haven't we? Husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way. What does that mean? Who's a husband here? Okay, we got a bunch. What does that mean? That means that you think about your wife. You try to understand her. I heard Bob tell us that. You need to become a student of your wife. What is it that she needs? What is it that you must provide? But what also pleases her? You need to do that and show that you love her. Five love languages. Have we heard this before? Wives, live in a submissive way to your husband. What does that mean? Well, thank God, Bob Brewer took care of that. I don't have to talk about it again. But if you think about it, ladies, it's living a way where when your husband comes home and he shares a decision with you, maybe you don't question him on every single decision, but you trust him as he's hard after following God. Maybe you support him and you encourage him. How many men don't need encouragement? Donna, how many? No, I promised her I wouldn't pick her out on the first day. But if I asked Donna right now, how many times have I said, hey, how about a little encouragement, honey? Right? We need it. You are to be his helpmeet. You're to support him. You're to move forward with your family together. What would it mean for our slaves and masters, right? Business owners, bosses, if you lived the way we were called to live in 1 Peter? What would this world think about you? What about school? What if you students who go to school, and some of you go, well, I'm homeschooled, I'm off the hook, I don't have to worry about this one. Go ahead. Scotty, I'm talking to you. You were homeschooled, right? There's a teacher and a student in that relationship, isn't there? And there, we got a bunch of teachers. Who's a teacher in this congregation? You too, Christy. You homeschool. Donna homeschools. We got some actual professional elementary school, high school teachers. What would it be like if we led our students as their teachers in love? What would it be like, you students, if you responded to your teachers the way that they want to be responded to? Appreciate how hard it is to teach today. I'm hoping y'all cut me some slack and give me a little grace too, as I'm one of your teachers, right? What would it look like in Safeway if we lived this way? What would it look like at the Maverick gas station or the U-Haul when you're putting your trailer back and you do it in a considerate way? What would it look like in Lander if this church, if this body of believers would love one another the way Christ calls us to live? What would this community look like? And that's what this church is known for, right?
I mean, I'm sorry, folks. I get around a little bit. I know some people in Lander. My sister's lived here for quite some time.
And that's what you guys are known for. If you're a visitor in our church, this church is known for loving one another and serving each other and doing it exceptionally well. Donna and I are super excited about being a part of this church, but that's what we want to continue to do as we move forward into our community. If we can do that, if we can understand what God has done for us and clinging to that hope, like we learned in 1 Peter, love one another, what would this country be like today? Praise the Lord Jesus Christ. He is our perfect sacrifice. Would you pray with me? Lord God, we come before you as a church. We come before you and we seek to hear your voice that you spoke to us through the pen of all of these different men who wrote this holy scripture for us. Lord, we don't know what it means to be holy. We don't know what all of this means, but we're going to dig into it together. And we ask for you to give us again your grace and help us understand. Help us to respond to the gift that you've given to us. Help us to live the life that you've called us to live, to love you with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, and to love our brothers and our neighbors as ourselves. Help us, husbands, to love our wives, and wives to love our husbands. Help us, children, to respect and honor our parents. Help us, parents, not be too harsh with our kids. Help us as we work in our workplaces, as we move in our schools, as we serve our teachers, and as we serve those whom we teach. Help us to do all the things you've called us to. And we ask these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rich. Hey, we'll close up service today. Kind of focusing on a lot of what Rich said. We've added a little chorus to this, and it's not real hard. You'll recognize the tune, so stand with us as we get ready to dismiss. Come ye sinners, poor and wretched, weak and wounded, sick and sore. Jesus ready stands to save you, full of pity joined with power. He is able, he is able, he is willing, doubt no more. Come ye needy, come. God's free bounty glorified. True believer.
need a Savior. He's in the world today. Simply see your need of Him, and He will give you grace. Come, ye weary, heavy laden, bruised and broken by the fall. And if you tarry till you're better, you will never come at all. Not the righteous, not the righteous, nope, not the righteous. Sinners Jesus came to call. Let not conscience make you linger, nor of fitness fondly dream. Till the fitness He requires is to feel your need of Him. This He gives you, that's right. This He gives you. Venture on Him, venture wholly. Let no other trust in truth. None but Jesus, none but Jesus. Amen. None but Jesus. Let me just remind you who you are before you leave. But you are a chosen people and a royal priesthood, God's special possession, I love that part, that you may declare the praises of Him who called you out of darkness into His wonderful light. Once you were people, not a people, but now you are a people of God. And once you had not received mercy, but now you have. So now go use your gifts to get out there and serve others. Okay? Love you guys. Have a great Sunday.
Four. by my shame, but you took the cross and suffered in my place. You rescued me. I belong to you. Life will rise, death will die. Your love is mine. Your love is mine. Stains wash white. You paid the price. Your love is mine. Your love is mine.
I called your name. You looked my way. You looked my way. Called your name, you looked my way, you looked my way.